7 years ago, Travis came down to London from Scotland and in 1997 released their first album, Good Feeling, which marked them as a great new British talent. However, it was their second album, The Man Who, that propelled them into the limelight and the top of the charts.
When The Man Who came out, we toured and then we went straight into the Invisible Band, and it was a pretty much 3 year sort of stint of being away from home. Now I'm telling you now, it's not a bad life, you know what I mean? It's pretty cool, you know.
Lucky.
The life of, you know, the rock star is everything it's made out to be. But it comes at a price. You no longer look at your mates as mates, you start looking at work. And being away from home and never going home and all this, you know, you have wives and girlfriends going, you never come home, and you go on the phone to your mum and you talk to her like you're doing an interview.
The strain of constant promotion and touring took its toll on a band already in need of a break when Neil Primrose, the band's drummer, fractured a vertebra in a swimming accident.
It was a kick up the bum for us. It was not the best way to go about things, but it certainly woke us up. Focus from we were almost dead anyway. Dead in the water, pardon the pun.
There'd be no band without Neil. So you're just thinking about him getting better, and his kind of bravery and will and determination to get better was kind of inspiring to all of us to kind of get the band back together once we knew he was going to be make a full recovery.
I think we work best when we're faced with absolute, you know.
Yeah.
Over
adversity.
Yeah. I think we use tragedy as our fuel. I think when you have something that's taken away from you, when you get it back, you're like, it means more to you. It's, and in a way, you know, like being married, like I think when people get married, they fall in love, they do the whole courting and the honeymoon period and it's all nice. And then they have kids and then they work and then it's all these things and then maybe the passion goes a little bit and you start losing a little bit of, not love, but just like, ah. And then if you're lucky, you have the sense to go, this is quite good, let's maybe go and have a second honeymoon and try and pull it back together. And if you're lucky enough to have that, then you'll have it for life. And I think that's what we've had with this record.
It was like dating, you know, we'd kind of phone each other up and go, you want to go for a drink? Yeah, all right. Just go for a drink. How are you doing? All right. Seen this place in the Malacantyre, it's called Creer. It's just a converted farmhouse and it's mostly used by artists. It's like an artist retreat and it's up near his folks. I've got like a B&B up there, it's up near that. And he'd seen it and just said, you've got to see this place, it's amazing.
We'd go for walks and
go for walks hand in hand, watch the sunset.
It was lovely, yeah, and it was like sort of reaffirming a relationship.
A lot of the stuff we were doing in Scotland for the album was not even meant to be for the album, it was meant to be exploratory, just for us to have fun, get back together, see what it was like to play again. And ultimately, after listening to it, we were like, hang on, this is quite good. You know, we're doing nothing wrong here, this is great. Why do things the old way? Go to a fancy studio and get a producer in, and we can do this ourselves.
We're demoing stuff, really, and then listened to the stuff that we got and thought, this is the makings of a record. If we thought we were making a record, we probably would have
ourselves. Yeah. For me, this record like encapsulates the whole idea of how records should be made and were made, which is just a bunch of guys, you just do it and you sort of make mistakes and you're like, and you fart about and you've got this thing at the end of it. You do your artwork. I mean, the artwork to the cover, granted, Anton Corbijn did the photography, but he's a mate, you know? So it's like, your mate, he's a brilliant artist, so you get your mate in and I did the photos on my computer at home and did the arrangement and stuff and showed it to Anton. I was like, what do you think? And he's like, well, that's great. Video as well, Anton, and the album, us all just farting about. It's been the most creative, romantic, amazing time that we've had in the past year, and I'd love to think we could do it again.
We will.
Yeah?
Yeah, we will. Yeah, we will. We have to, because we can't end up in the position we ended up in, you know, after what happened. We're not going to let that happen again.
It's great. We kind of thought long and hard about it, and we're going to do. Usually, we have a certain set that we play, and we've been playing the same kind of songs and putting other songs in it. But with this show, we took the view. We were rehearsing the other day, and we thought, you know, we're going to just play new stuff and old stuff as well. But it's opening with brand new songs,
yeah.
So everyone's going to be standing in the audience like this. Don't know this one.
Soon will, though.
Yeah. Take me away, take me
today. I'm never gonna get away. I mean, I think that we've done like about 10, 11 shows, and we've been playing kind of pretty much half the new record. And it's been going down fantastic. Crowds have been, I mean, songs that they don't even know yet, they've been trying to sing along to, which is always a good sign.
I've been blown away by, we've never had it before, people coming up after shows and going, I mean, we kind of like the old stuff, mate, and that, but that new stuff is just something else. It's just like, what is it? And it's really great, you know, it's kind of cool.
Fantastic, like a choir!
I think it's a knock-on effect. What happened in the last year probably affected us, which affected the music, which affects the shows, you know? And I think, yeah, the show is something different now because it's got all this new stuff in it, and it re-energises the old songs and gives them a new lease of life, and it makes them slightly different.
Can be many things. Music's like liquid. You can pour it into any vessel and it will take the shape of that vessel. So it can be about the weather, it can be about flowers, it can be about, you know, something a little bit more lofty or weighty or whatever.
I don't pay taxes to drop bombs on people. I pay taxes for good education. I pay taxes for good healthcare. It's about time someone said something in a band. I don't know, I'm not going to go near Citizen Smith, but I just, you know, I was surprised no one said anything already, you know what I mean? Anyway, this is called The Beautiful Occupation.
I'm writing as I've always done, from experience. I don't see the point of writing a song when you're just talking.
The album isn't realised and live performance isn't realised until the audience is either listening to the record or in the venue. Only then does it all make sense. But you've still got to play every show like it's your last.
If it's quiet,
it makes you absolutely yourself. Because you remember like playing gigs when, like, you know, 7 or 8 years ago when there was two people there. And it's really disconcerting because you start worrying about those two people. Well, the bigger the crowd, the less it's like, you know, so the more you can feed off like an energy that's coming towards you. Whereas there's two people, you're wondering what they had for their dinner.
No. What did you think of that?
Did you like that song? No? Okay.
I'll do another one.
It's okay. Don't need an invitation to drop in upon a nation. We just want to go out there. I mean, we're playing a lot of the new stuff tonight, and things, so you just want people to listen.
There's two we've never done before that we're doing tonight. Every day, sinking in the quicksand, follow me down the drain. But it doesn't matter anyway. You're gonna get yours any day. Quicksand, which is the first song on the record, and a song called Midlife Crisis, which we've never played before, so that's quite nerve-wracking.
There's nothing better than seeing people just lost in music, because it's just like an abandoning all cool and abandoning everything, because what is the definition of cool is I think wrong these days. The definition of cool is just pure abandon and just not, you know, just being lost in it, lost in music. And there's nothing better than being at a show when a band are just lost, and you can be lost too with them, and everyone's, you just become one thing. I let go completely, like, I'll go into another, but I just let a trance. I can be singing, playing, and be thinking about, you know, and be at home, a wee cat. Oh, did I feed him?
I go off into my own wee world and sort of dream when I'm on stage and I'm not afloat. But and then you'll sort of look at someone and start thinking about them and sort of what they're doing, and, you know, whether they're enjoying it or not. And then you'll realise that you don't know where you are in a song. So I tend to sort of drift off a bit.
I don't. Yeah. I kind of just have sheer blind panic most of the time. I just kind of try and not look like I'm about to fall to bits.
Grown up a bit, you know what I mean, but not too much, you know what I mean. I think there are more important things to life than you know, making a fool of yourself on stage, you know. But we love making fools of ourselves on stage, and we'll keep doing it as long as we've got as long as our arthritis, you know, holds our legs together. It is so great to be back together in a room together. And that is the most important thing. And to be going on a stage and just going for it and I don't know, it's just, you're right, you know, you feel, I don't know what it is that energises you. It's in a way we're very, very lucky.